Welcome, everyone. Welcome to our Saturday 6 p.m. service. That's where you find yourself. All right. Good to be with you. Good to be with you here. Good to be with you in the upper room. And good to be with you online if you're joining us online as well. My name is Marvin, one of the pastors on staff here. Just want to say hello to each and every one of you. I greet you all and especially love to greet those of you that might be with us for the very first time. I know I met some folks out in the courtyard on your way in. Thank you for being with us. If this is your first time, thank you. Welcome. We love that you are here. We would love to get to know you, and really the easiest way for us to follow up with you is if you would fill out the connection card. That's a little card that's right in the seat in front of you. So if you want to grab that card, it says connection card on it, give us some information, drop it in the offering bag. Someone on our team will call you this week. We just want to get to know you. We want to pray with you. We want to tell you more about our church and tell you and ask how we might be of service to you. Also, there's a new people's table, and that's out in the lobby. You can stop by that new people's table. We have a free gift for you this evening as a way of saying thank you. Well, we've got some information for you. I'm going to give you some announcements. All of this information is in your bulletin. It's on our app. It's on our website. So please check those things out. We have a class starting on Sunday, October 15th, entitled Before I Do. And this is for those couples who are in a season of life where they're considering marriage. Maybe you're engaged. Maybe you're dating in a serious long-term relationship. This is not the place for you to come find somebody. But if you have somebody, bring them with you to the Before I Do class. Sunday, October 15th, couples are gonna be talking about communication, conflict resolution, finances, and lots of really good topics. So if that's of interest to you, make sure you sign up for the class again, Sunday, October 15th. We're gonna be hosting a baptism class also on Sunday, October 15th at 1 p.m. And that's gonna be happening right over to my right in the family room over here. And it's just really the next step in your walk with Jesus. So if you've given your life to Jesus as your Lord and Savior, the very next best thing that the Bible encourages us to do is to be baptized. So come to the baptism class. Again, Sunday, October 15th at 1 o'clock. The baptism service will happen in the month of November. If you are 65 or over, we have a community for you. It's called Seasoned Seniors. And they're going to be hosting a potluck lunch on Thursday, October 19th from 11:30 to 1. Details are in your bulletin, so you can follow up with that. But we'd love for you to join that community as well. Fusion is going to be hosting a Revive one-night conference. Fusion is our 18 to 35-year-old young adult community, and that's going to be happening on Friday, October 20th. The topic for this conference is discovering God's purpose for your life. And so if you're 18 to 35, or if you know someone 18 to 35, invite you to come on out and be a part of the Revive one-night conference. And finally, we're going to be hosting a six-week-long apologetics class. It's going to be a partner class with the teaching series that we're currently on with All of Your Mind. It's going to allow us to go deeper into some of those topics that we've covered, as well as some topics that were not covered in this teaching series. Mike Williams, who has a master's degree in Christian apologetics, will be hosting the class. It's going to be happening Thursdays from 7 to 8:30 p.m., and the venue has changed. It is now going to be happening in this sanctuary. So again, starting this Thursday from 7 p.m. to 8:30 p.m., invite you to come on out. There's still time for you to register. You can go online and get some more information. There will be times for questions and answers as well. So all that information, again, is in your bulletin. I know it's a lot, but follow up with us on the bulletin and on our app as well. I'm going to invite our ushers in just a few moments to help us to continue our time of worship by giving of our tithes and offerings. And we say this, if you're new, really don't want anything from you during this time. If you choose to participate, thank you so much for doing that. To our CA family, thank you for your ongoing generosity and the ways you continue to invest in God and His kingdom. Psalm 136, verse 1 says the following. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good, for His steadfast love endures forever. So as we give, let's give out of a heart of thankfulness for God's goodness. Would you pray with me? Lord, we love You. We've sung songs about how we offer our praise to You, Lord. And Lord, now in a real practical and tangible way, would You receive our tithes and offerings as an act of worship, Lord. We do so with all of our heart, Father God. Thank You for the ways that You bless us, both spiritually and materially, Lord. We love You, Jesus. Amen.
Well, if you're a visitor or a guest, my name is Tom, and what an honor and a privilege to have you here among us. And of course, to my CA family, great to be with you as well. And I want to welcome those of you who are online and those of you who will be catching this at 1115 South as well. What a joy to be with you on this weekend. Last weekend, I got the privilege and opportunity to go up to Portland, Oregon, and speak at one of our sister churches up there that Keith Jenkins leads. And so I was up there, and they wanted me to bring the greeting back down to you all. And so I greet you, you know, from all our brothers and sisters in Christ who are up there. And it was a joy to be with them, but great to be back together with you. You've already heard about our apologetics class. And when we were talking about it, I talked with Mike about that class. I booked our largest classroom, and you all signed up at such a rate that we can't fit you in our largest classroom. At last count, I think there was 130 people who registered. And so that's why we're moving it into this South Sanctuary. So we're going to be in here. Yeah, you can applaud God at work, right? And so we're going to be here, and it's going to start this Thursday at 7 p.m. And so at this point, now that we know that we're in this venue, you don't even need to register now, because now we pretty much have a seat for you unless more than 800 of you show up. So therefore, come and be with us at 7 o'clock. It'll be great. I loved Mike last week, if you were with us, spoke about how Christianity is the true story of the world. And even when he said that, you know, I just felt that my faith was built up from his little interview that he did. One other thing I want to call your attention to is the month of October is Pastoral Appreciation Month, and it's even in LA County, they just declared it Pastoral Appreciation Month in honor of all the work that faith leaders do. And the reason I'm bringing this up is so many of you will know that we have a wide staff serving from, you know, the youngest of our kids to the eldest of our senior citizens and every different way you can think of. And honestly, I think sometimes people who are the senior pastors get too much credit, and it really requires an entire team of people. And so I want to encourage you, church, to find a way to encourage the pastors that are impacting you. If you've got teenagers, say thank you to the youth pastors. If you've got little kids, community life pastors, worship pastors, whoever it might be, want to encourage you this month to find a way to just express your gratitude. It can be as simple as looking them in the eye and saying, thank you for all you're doing to invest in my life and the life of our students. Well, today we continue on in our series with All Your Mind, and we come to the question that many, if not all of us, have wrestled with at some point in our lives. And here's the question. If God is real and good and powerful and all loving, then why does he allow evil in this world? I mean, you just turn on the news and Hamas attacks Israel. Why is that happening? Why is that allowed, God? You turn on the news and there's an ongoing oppressive war happening in Armenia, in Ukraine. I mean, the list could go on. And I'm certain some of you are like, well, but you didn't mention that other war that's occurring. Like, there's so much going on that you could just, and that's just wars, let alone other forms of interpersonal evil. And before we get too far into this, I want to frame our time together this weekend. We're going to dig into this question intellectually, which I want to be really clear to you. This is not something that I do whenever I'm sitting with somebody who's hurting. In fact, last week I was in the hospital, and by the way, I went into this hospital and I was going to pray for someone who had cancer, and I ran into like 10 people who are part of our church who serve in various capacities in that one hospital. Everything from doctors to janitors, to nurses, to EMTs, and the list goes on. And if you're part of the medical community, I just want to thank you for all you do to care for us in our greatest times of need. And so thank you for that. Yeah. And so there's an emotional side to this question, and I just want to acknowledge that when we feel disappointed with God or confused by life, and if you're in that season, if this question is not just intellectual for you in this moment in time, but it's an emotional question, I want to refer you to three helpful resources. The first is week number 3 of the last series we did called The Grudge, where it's available on our website, and I addressed the question of what do we do emotionally and spiritually and practically when we feel disappointed with God. We don't understand what he's doing. We feel disappointed with life. So that would be one resource. The second is that on our website, we have something that we've written called A Guide to Grief. And if you go on our website and there's a tab that says resources and you click on it, there'll be a drop-down box and you can download that PDF, and it's the very best of both the pastoral resources and the Christian counseling resources brought together. Our own team worked on it and drafted that. I have given that resource to many people who've maybe lost a loved one, and it's just been helpful for them to learn what to expect and how grief works and work through some of the scriptures and do some kind of writing and reflection, some exercises. So Guide to Grief, that would be the second resource. The third, I want to encourage you, if you're in a season of deep grief, to consider seeing a Christian grief counselor. I did that after the loss of my parents. My dad died in 2013. My mom died in 2020. And after my dad died, a year later, I went and spent an entire week just with a grief counselor. We did 4 hours every day. It was kind of intense. And yet it really helped me understand as well as weather through that storm. And I want to encourage you, if you're somebody who's experiencing a deep level of loss or grief, don't think if I just grit my teeth and put my head down, I'll just push my way through it. You might push your way through it for a little bit, but if you stuff it down, it's going to come back up. I'm just telling you right now, like if you just like, no, counseling works for you, Tom, but it doesn't work for me. No, you need it too. And you probably need it more than me if you don't think you need counseling. So I just want to encourage you. I at least know that when I have grief, I got to talk with someone about it. You either talk out grief or you act out grief. That's what happens in life. I've watched thousands of lives unfold. I deal with grief all the time. I've done all sorts of funerals. I'm telling you now, you either talk it out and pray it through or you're going to be acting it out. That's what's going to happen in your life. So I want to encourage you on that. Now, with those resources and with that being said, let's try to love God with all our mind by digging into this question. Someone might say, well, Tom, listen, the Bible teaches that there's a good, loving, all-knowing, all-powerful God, and yet the reality is that evil exists. How do we make any sense of that? Does it mean that God's not good? Does it mean that he's not all-powerful? Is he not all-knowing? Or is something else going on? And we're going to consider that. But before we do, let's pray. So, Father, we thank you for your word and how your word, Jesus, you invite us to love God with all of our mind. And part of loving God with all of our mind is wrestling with these challenging questions. And Lord, these aren't just theoretical questions. The news headlines are telling us about the attacks and the war happening in Israel. And so, Lord, as your word instructs from the Psalms, we pray for the peace of Israel, Lord. And we pray not only for the peace of Israel, Lord, I pray for the Palestinian Christians who had nothing to do with the attack and yet are caught in the midst of all of this conflict. We pray for the Armenian conflict that's going on and the injustice there as well. Lord, we pray for the Ukrainian war. And Lord, it just feels like at every turn, there's just evil occurring. And so God, we ask for you to be at work. And Lord, as we come to your word now, whether we're online, whether we're here in person, God, I pray that you would speak to us. We gather not to hear a message from me. We gather to hear a word from you. In Jesus' name, amen. On your way, and hopefully you got a bulletin. If you did, flip it open to this little center section. You'll see 90% of the Bible in small print that is there for you. So pull out your magnifying glass on that one, I think. And so you can look at that, and we'll hopefully also have it come up on the screens as well. As you might imagine, this set of questions of like, Tom, the Bible teaches that God is all-powerful and good and loving and all-knowing, and yet evil exists. How do we make sense of that? This is not a new set of questions. This wasn't like something that nobody thought of these questions until last month, but it is worth noting that until about 1500 AD, these questions were not asked as often as they're asked today. And why is that? And the answer on why that is what we call our worldview. I talked about this on week one, that we have a worldview that is underneath all of our questions, and often it happens unconsciously, and we haven't always kind of looked at our worldview to intentionally cross-examine it, And so we often have like just kind of a mishmash of beliefs that sit underneath our questions that really are the soil from which our questions grow. And sometimes those beliefs are actually contradictory. And sometimes if you pull them out and look at them, you might say, well, I don't even believe that. But that's in my worldview, and I'm now asking a question around it. So our worldview is a collection of assumptions and beliefs which shape the way in which we view the world, and they often sit in the background of our thoughts without being intentionally examined. So up until about 1500 AD, the main line of reasoning on this question went like this, that we people, we humanity, we are finite and God is infinite. So their line of reasoning went like this. We're finite, God's infinite, so it would only stand to reason that God can be good and all-powerful and yet allow temporary suffering for reasons that we cannot fully understand due to our limitations, not God's limitations. That we're the limiting factor. But after about 1500 AD, we humans began to believe more in our power to acquire knowledge, to the point that some philosophers thought, you know, given enough time, humanity will have all knowledge. And now it's not even so much we talk about humans doing that, we talk about AI doing that, right? You give it enough time and, you know, they're gonna have it all sorted out. The machines are gonna be ruling us, some of the people say. And look, the reality is the acquisition of more and more knowledge has served us in a lot of ways. It served us in modern medicine and better engineering for our homes, and the list goes on. But the growth in those fields of knowledge subtly shifts our thinking in this way. We begin to think, and you see this more and more in moral reasoning and philosophy, after 1500, we begin to think this way. If we can't understand why a good God allows evil, then it must not be our limits, it must be his limits. That he's not good, or he's not all-knowing, or he's not all-powerful. Because we have an ever-increasing amount of knowledge, so if we can't understand it, it's not that we're the limiting factor, it's that God is the limiting factor. And so the worldview that we live in is actually the soil from which this question grows. And yet it is worth asking ourselves, is it more likely that we are limited in our understanding, or is it more likely that God is limited in his power and knowledge? Now, if you were here the last several weeks, week 2 and 3 in particular of the series, we talked about how God created the universe, and I went through all sorts of scientific stuff. And if you were there and if you heard all that, and I just gave you a fraction of what I read, it's pretty clear that we're the limited ones and he's the unlimited one. That if you just look at that information of cutting-edge science, that it's more logical to believe that the constraining limitation is our capacity, not God's capacity. And that, therefore, indeed, God can be good and all-powerful, and yet do things that we who are neither all-good nor all-powerful nor all-knowing would understand. Now, this whole set of questions in the field of apologetics is called the problem of evil. Now, what is evil? Evil can be defined a lot of different ways. But philosophically, one way it can be defined as is that evil is a lack of good. The African bishop, St. Augustine, pointed this out, noting that evil is not a thing in itself, but it's a lack of good. It's like having a shirt that has a hole in it. The hole is not a thing in and of itself. It's just the lack of the shirt in that particular space. So Augustine and others have noted that the existence of evil philosophically, logically, points to the existence of God. Because without a good and holy God, how would we even know what evil is? Or think of it this way. How would you know that a line is crooked if no straight line exists? The only way that you can know a line is crooked is if there's the existence of a straight line by which the definition of crooked is set relative to the absolute of the straight line. Just as hunger points to the existence of food, evil points to the existence of something or someone who is not evil, but is in fact good. Here's how the Bible puts it in Psalm 25, verse 8 and 9. Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore, he instructs sinners in the way, and he leads everyone in what is right. No, that's not what it says. He leads the humble, and he teaches the humble his way. Humility is part of how we approach God. Arrogance, if you're arrogant enough, you're like, well, I don't want to approach God, or I don't need God, or I know more than God knows. He says, no, I lead the humble in what is right and teach the humble my ways. And then Psalm 145, verse 8 through 10, the Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all. Isn't that good news? And his mercy is over all that he has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your saints shall bless you. Now, St. Augustine, in his treatise on this topic, he noted that this question of evil and good, it cuts both ways. So if we say that there's no God because evil exists, then we're just left with the opposite question, which is if there's no God, then why is there so much good in the world? If the world is meaningless and purposeless and godless place, where does the good come from? Where does beauty come from? Where does love come from? And you only have to look at the headlines to know that it doesn't just come from us, because we're not always all good to each other all the time. Now, it's worth identifying that there are types of evil that we find in this world, and there's a couple main types. One is a moral evil, which is an evil done by people in their actions, and the other is a natural evil. These would be things like, you know, floods and earthquakes and tornadoes. And we'll talk a little bit more about the application of those two different groupings as we go. Which brings me to the first main thing that I want us to know, which is this, is that evil exists because God gives people free will. Genesis 1:31 says this, God saw all that he had made, and it was very good indeed. Evening came, and then morning, the sixth day. So at this point in creation, people's experience was only very good indeed. There was no evil mixed into it. There was no deprivation of good. There was no lack of good. There was no hole in the shirt, so to speak. But in Genesis 3, Adam and Eve are deceived by the serpent. They choose to eat the fruit that will move their experience from being a very good only experience to where they will now know, and actually in Hebrew, the word know includes this idea of experiencing something. So it says Adam knew Eve, and she bore him a son. That didn't mean that he intellectually knew she was walking around the garden, right? There's an experiential knowing that it's talking about. And now they're not only going to know intellectually, but they're going to experience not only good but also evil, because they chose to eat of the fruit. So certainly we see here and elsewhere in the Bible that the serpent, known as Satan throughout Scripture, is part of the reason of the existence of evil. Adam and Eve did not trust God. They trusted the serpent, and they trusted themselves more than they trusted God. So they ate of the tree that God forbid them to eat, knowing that it would introduce evil, it would mix evil into their good only experience up to that point in time. And as a result of their sin, look at what God says the world would be like for humans in Genesis 3:16 and on. Then he said to the woman, I will sharpen the pain of your pregnancy, and in pain you will give birth, and you will desire to control your husband, and he will rule over you. And to the man he said, since you listened to your wife and ate from the tree of the fruit that I commanded you not to eat, the ground is cursed because of you. All of your life you will struggle to scratch a living from it. You wonder why you feel frustrated at work? That's why. It will grow thorns and thistles for you, though you will eat of its grains. By the sweat of your brow, you will have food to eat, because up to that point, they didn't have it by the sweat of their brow. You will have food to eat until you return to the ground from which you were made, for you were made from dust, and dust you will return. So the free will of Adam and Eve resulted in the experience of evil being mixed in to their previously only good, very good experience. And notice that their free will here doesn't only affect them, but it affects creation as a whole. And that's important to understand. Now, why would that happen? Because God had given Adam and Eve the place of dominion or stewardship or rulership over the earth. They were to be the image of God, male and female. He created them. They were to be stewards and bring the very best out of creation. So when they broke faith by their own free will, it not only affected them, it affected the creation that God had created for them to live in, which up to that point had been a good only experience. And let me just be crystal clear to you, as an environmental science major, don't be naive to think, oh, my decisions don't impact the environment at all. They do. Like, I think we should all know that and just be aware of that. And that's actually part of how God created the world to function and the environment to function and our role within it. We can affect it positively or negatively. You know, Los Angeles in 1980, the air was way worse than it is right now. And it's way worse, not because there's fewer people who live in LA now than we did in 1980. It's because we made some decisions about the type of air we wanted to breathe, and we set some regulations in place. Same thing actually with our groundwater. Our groundwater is cleaner now in LA than it was in 1980. And that's because of some decisions that were being made about what we think is important about the environment that we want to live in. And so that's part of how God's created it. So God did that, and then when they broke faith, it didn't just affect them, it infected and affected the world around them. This is called the fall from grace, and the fall corrupted everything. It doesn't mean that nothing had any components of good left in it. It's that every part of creation was now corrupted or vandalized in some way. It became a mixture of not only good, but now also evil. And Paul will echo and demonstrate that our free will has this pervasive effect on all creation, including ourselves in Romans 8. In verse 18, it says, "Yet what we suffer now is nothing compared to the glory he will reveal to us later." And here it is. "For all creation is waiting eagerly." All of creation is waiting eagerly for the future day when God will reveal who his children really are. Against its will. So creation didn't do it. We did it. Against its will, all creation was subjected to God's curse. But with eager hope, the creation looks forward to the day when it will join God's children in glorious freedom from death and decay. Because our free will introduced death and decay into creation. "For we know that all creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up until the present time. And we believers also groan, even though we have the Holy Spirit within us as a foretaste of glory, of future glory. We long for our bodies to be released from sin and suffering." Our bodies were not originally created to die or decay. It was our free will that introduced the fall and sin and suffering and our bodies breaking down. People will wonder, like, why is there disease? Why does that happen? Well, because the fall happened and that corrupted our bodies. And so our bodies no longer, apart from Christ, are able to live forever. We need to have a new body. That's part of why Christ came. He goes on and says, "We too wait with eager hope for the day when God will give us our full rights as adopted children, including what? The new bodies he's promised for us." So we've corrupted them, we've decayed them, and introduced the fall into reality. And part of the Gospels we'll get to is that God doesn't let that be the end of the story, but actually he says, look, your perishable bodies are going to be planted in the ground, but I'm going to give you an imperishable one if you come to know Christ and you're resurrected with Christ. So tornadoes and earthquakes and natural disasters and many diseases, they're the product of the corruption of the fall. We have no indication that any of these things existed prior to Adam and Eve mixing into their, up to that point, their only very good experience. Now, part of me, I remember when I was a little boy and I heard about this, I was like mad at Adam and Eve for like, I don't know, like 3 weeks or something. And I'm like, "You ruined it for the rest of us. Like, you know, I don't like you, Adam. I'm mad at you. You messed it up." But the reality is that all of us make the same choice. We too choose to listen and trust ourselves or the logic, the broken, fallen logic of the enemy when he comes to tempt us as well. We too will turn away and say, "Well, I don't know if God's really good. Maybe he doesn't really have my best in mind. Maybe he doesn't really love me." And when we do that, we unleash evil and pain and suffering into our lives and the lives of those around us. But when you see how devastating and powerful the effects of free will is, it makes you wonder, if God is all-knowing and he knew that this would happen, then why did he let us have free will at all? Like, God, if you knew that was going to happen, why did you even allow that to occur? Which brings me to the second thing, which is this, is that free will exists because God is love, and love requires free will. 1 John 4:8 says this, is that God is love. That means love isn't just something that God does, it's the very nature of who he is. And the problem with free will is that it creates the possibility of people to do evil, to hate God or to hate their neighbors. But it is the same gift of free will that gives us the possibility to love, whether to love God or to love others. Love requires free will. C.S. Lewis says it this way, free will, though it makes evil possible, is the only thing that makes possible any love or goodness or joy worth having at all. Allison and I, my wife, we're coming up on 26 years of marriage, and I love her and she loves me. But it would not be a genuine love if I put her in a headlock and said, you have to be married to me. That wouldn't be a genuine love, right? That wouldn't be, she needs to have free will. I need to have free will to freely choose to enter into that. So if God created a world without free will, would we have a world without hate? Yes. Would we have a world without suffering? Yes. But we would also have a world without love, which is the highest value in the universe, because God is love. So to enter into the highest value of the universe, you have to allow for the possibility of some of the lowest values of the universe to come into our lives. Free will requires a choice, and free will is given, and it's necessary to ever receive or give love. Now, we tend to blame God for our suffering, but in Genesis, the potential for sin and evil to enter into humanity's experience was not actualized by God, but by people. So the blame biblically ultimately lies with us. God did his part perfectly. We're the ones who didn't trust him. We're the ones who messed it up. And most of the pain in the world is caused by our choices. Our choices to kill and to slander, to be selfish, to stray sexually, to break our promises, to be people who are just selfish and out for our own, to create injustice, to be part of that, to believe a lie or a deception or more. And the rest of the pain of the world and suffering in the world is due to the nature of fallen creation, which was unleashed by humanity's free will and the decision to mix evil into our experience because we believe the lie of the serpent over the truth of God. There's an old cartoon of two different turtles, and one turtle says, sometimes I'd like to ask God why he allows poverty and famine and injustice when he could do something about it, to which the other turtle says, I'm afraid God might ask me those same questions. Those of us who choose to follow Jesus, we need to live out our faith in part by alleviating suffering where we can, by making a difference, by embodying love, his love in a practical way. To, as Jesus says, to love your neighbor as ourselves. And by the way, church, I just want to say to you, thank you for the kind of people that you are that are doing this. You're doing it in your prayers, you're doing it in your serving, you're doing it in your giving. You're bearing one another's burdens. In fact, last Tuesday, the LA County Board of Supervisors took up a motion to study medical debt in Los Angeles, California. 10 million people live in our county, and they're considering purchasing and retiring all the medical debt that is left in the secondary market for the poor, a penny on a dollar. And guess where they got this idea from? And so it got approved 5-0, and they called it the Christian Assembly National Movement, which kind of made me chuckle. And they called it that because in 2019, we canceled the medical debt for the poor in 28 neighborhoods in kind of where you all live and we all live. And then a bunch of people all around the world, it became a viral news story, they gave money and we took the money that came in from Hong Kong and Brazil and all these other places and we canceled debt all over the country. And so they literally said, like, would you write a letter in support of this? Because we're doing this because we're inspired by the people of Christian Assembly Church. And so they're engaging with everything you can think of, from hospital CEOs to CEOs of insurance companies and pharmaceutical companies, to study how is it that we can make it so that people who get cancer, who had health insurance, but they met their cap and they still needed more chemo, can we find a way that we're not just rolling this debt up and rolling it around their neck? Because it's different than consumer debt. This isn't about they didn't discipline their budget enough. Like, when you have the choice between either take the chemo pill that's $100,000 or die, we choose to take the pill and try to figure out the debt later. And so the reality is they're saying, hey, we're going to study this and we're trying to figure this out because the people of Christian Assembly have been loving to their neighbors. And so, church, you're doing this, and we're doing our little part, and God takes it, and he multiplies it in ways that we could never imagine. Right now, our ministries are helping people get off the streets. We're sponsoring tiny homes. We're helping crisis pregnancies. We're mentoring at-risk kids. We're helping people break addictions, and the list could go on. But none of that would be happening without you, without you deciding, I'm going to use my free will to love my neighbors as myself. I'm going to use my free will to love God because I know how much God loves me. Brings us to the third thing, which is this, is that God's answer to the problem of suffering is that he came right down into it. The Bible is unique in this way. Christianity is unique in this way. Of all the world religions, all the worldviews, including secular humanism and the rest, of all the world religions, listen to this, Christianity is the only one whose God has scars. Allah doesn't have any scars. Vishnu doesn't have any scars. Buddha doesn't have any scars. Jesus loved us to the point of using his free will to come and lay down his life for all who would come to him by faith and trusting in him for our salvation. N.T. Wright says it this way. He's a theologian. He says, what the Gospels offer is not a philosophical explanation of evil, what it is or why it's there, nor a set of suggestions how we might adjust our lifestyles so that evil will mysteriously disappear from the earth. But what they are is the story of an event in which the living God deals with it. Romans 5, 15 to 17 says it this way, but there's a great difference between Adam's sin and God's gracious gift. For the sin of this one man, Adam, brought death to many, but even greater is God's wonderful grace and his gift of forgiveness to many through this other man, Jesus Christ. And the result of God's gracious gift is very different from the result of the one man's sin. For Adam's sin led to condemnation, but God's free gift leads to ours being made right with God, even though we are guilty of many sins. For the sin of this one man, Adam, caused death to rule over many, but even greater is God's wonderful grace and his gift of righteousness. For all who receive it will live in triumph over sin and death through this one man, Jesus Christ. In my greatest moments of loss and grief and suffering and evil and sorrow, I don't want someone to explain evil to me. I want someone to be with me in it. And Christ came not only to be with us in our sorrow. He did, and he gets us. But then he laid down his life to pay for our sins to overcome the world. Which brings me to the fourth thing, which is this, is that the Bible never says that this is the best world. Instead, it's that this is the best way to the best world. The Bible doesn't brush past evil or sorrow. It's not like Hinduism that says it's all just an illusion. Or you're just, whatever evil's happening to you, it's all your fault because you must have done something in your previous life, so now you're just getting paid back for what you did from your former life, which raises the question, then what are you paying for from your first birth? I mean, it just, logically, Hinduism doesn't even make sense. Jesus says it this way in John 16, 33, here on earth you'll have many trials and sorrows, but take heart, I have overcome the world. In fact, Jesus tells parables, and one of them he tells about a field with wheat And an enemy came and sowed weeds in, and the wheat and the weeds grow up together. There's an acknowledgement of the mixture of our experience. We live in a mixed world. You can look at good going on, you can look at evil going on. And certainly the Bible is clear that Satan, our tempter and accuser, has a role in evil and oppression along with our own sinful choices. And we can think, well, you know, in this world, this evil world, people that are evil, they just get away with it. But that's not the case ultimately. Even here now, we can see ways that God is at work to restrain evil through courts and laws and justice, through his Holy Spirit, through the preaching and teaching of his word, through our consciences, through angels, through those who are choosing to love their neighbor. But yet still, even though evil is restrained, it exists. And evil is done. And the Bible teaches that ultimately in 2 Corinthians 5:10, it says, "For all of us must appear before the judgment seat of Christ so that each may receive recompense for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil." So then justice delayed is not the same as justice denied. As the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said, "I believe that unarmed truth and unconditional love will have the final word in reality. This is why right temporarily defeated is stronger than evil triumphant." The Bible teaches not just one creation, but two. There's a new creation, a new earth, a new world that's coming, and it's made possible by the work of Jesus Christ. So then at that point, once we understand that, the point of this life that we're in right now isn't comfort. The point of this life biblically is training and preparation for eternity. The point of this life is soul building. Revelation 21:1 says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the old heaven and the old earth had disappeared. The sea was also gone. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven like a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud shout from the throne saying, 'Look, home, God's home is now with his people. He will live with them and they will be his people. God himself will be with them. And he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death and no more sorrow, no more crying and no more pain. All these things are gone forever.' And the one sitting on the throne said, 'Look, I'm making everything new.'" So this first creation that we live in is preparing us for something, namely, according to the Bible, to rule and live with God in the world to come. Because the first world he gave us to rule and live in, we messed up because we didn't trust him. So to be entrusted with that responsibility, we must learn to overcome good with evil, which can only happen by us overcoming good with evil. Romans 12:21 says, "Don't let evil conquer you, but conquer evil by doing good." Tom, what is God doing about evil? Well, part of what he's doing about evil is that as you come to Christ and Christ works in you, he's teaching you to overcome evil by doing good, to love your neighbors and to love your enemies and to pray for those who persecute you. Now, I think we would all know, even though we might not like it, that we learn profound things through suffering. Vacations and video games are great, but they don't grow our soul. Scottish theologian James S. Stewart says it this way: "It is the spectators, the people who are outside looking at the tragedy, from whose ranks the skeptics come. It is not those who are actually in the arena who know suffering from the inside. Indeed, the fact is that the world's greatest sufferers have produced the most shining examples of unconquerable faith. In some sense, I would say, only in a world where faith is difficult can faith genuinely exist at all. I don't need to have faith to believe that 2 + 2 = 4. I don't need to have faith to believe that the noonday sun is shining. Those things are self-evident. But faith is a requirement of entering into the new world that Jesus is creating. Why? Because we can't save ourselves from our sin. But I also think because if we have genuine faith, then when we're into the full summation of the kingdom of God, we will retain our free will but not want to sin in heaven and on the new earth, because we'll know what it has been like before it had been separated from God and having lived on this fallen earth. And now we'll know the experience of living in an unfallen world remade by Christ in the new earth forever. As we read previously from Romans 8, we're given this promise Yet what we suffer now is nothing compared to the glory he'll later reveal. Before we pray and come to the communion table, I want to close with an extended quote from Dr. Peter Kreeft, who's a professor of philosophy at Boston College. This is what he says. Jesus is there, sitting beside us in the lowest places of our lives. Are we broken? He was broken like bread for us. Are we despised? He was despised and rejected of men. Do we cry out that we can't take it anymore? He was a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. Do people betray us? He was sold out himself. Are our tenderest relationships broken? He too loved and was rejected. Do people turn from us? They hid their faces from him as from a leper. Does he descend into all of our hells? Yes, he does. From the depths of a Nazi death camp, Corrie Ten Boom wrote, "No matter how deep our darkness, he is deeper still." He not only rose from the dead, he changed the meaning of death, and therefore all the little deaths and the sufferings that anticipate death and make up parts of it. He is gassed in Auschwitz. He is sneered in Soweto. He is mocked in North Ireland. He is enslaved in the Sudan. He's the one that we love to hate, yet he's chosen to return love. Every tear we shed shall become his tear. And he might not wipe them away yet, but he will. And in the end, God has only given us partial explanations. Maybe that's because he saw that a better explanation wouldn't have been good for us. I don't know why, but as a philosopher, of course, I'm obviously curious. Humanly, I wish he had given more information. But he knew Jesus was more than an explanation. He is what we really need. If your friend is sick and dying, the most important thing he wants is not an explanation. He wants you to sit with him. He's terrified of being alone more than anything else. And so God has not left us alone. And for that, I love him. Let's pray. God, we thank you for our free will. And for those online and those at 1115 South and those here, I'm asking you would help us to use our free will for good and not evil. We can't control everything, but we can control our part. Help me to love you with all my mind and strength and heart and soul, and to love my neighbors as myself, to pray for those who persecute me, to love my enemies. For those of you who are in a season of suffering, I just want you to hear that you're not alone. Christ has entered into our suffering. And may you find Christ to be very close with you in your pain. And may the hope of a new heaven, a new earth encourage you and strengthen your soul. In this world we will have trouble, but take heart, for Christ has overcome the world. And Father, we thank you that this fallen world is not the end of the story. Thank you for creating a new world, a new earth, a new creation. And let us live now in light of the reality of that coming truth with faith and hope and love in Jesus Christ. God's ultimate answer to evil is that he descended into it, freely of his own free will. Jesus came. On the night that he was betrayed, he gathered his disciples, he took a loaf of bread, he blessed it, and then he broke it, and he said, "This bread is my body, which is broken for you. As often as you eat this, do this in remembrance of me." And then likewise, he took a cup and said, "This is the cup of the shedding of my blood. As often as you drink this, do this in remembrance of me." And what are we remembering? Well, we're remembering Jesus. And we're remembering that apart from Jesus, there is no salvation. And we're remembering that no matter how much evil comes into our life, Jesus can meet us. He can meet us right in the midst of it. He too has experienced sorrow and pain, rejection and grief. And he came to die for us and our salvation so that evil done to us or the evil we've done to others wouldn't have the last word. But if we come to him by faith, we can be made new and we can become part of the new creation. Let's pray. Father, we ask even now, before we come to your table, would you search our hearts? It's a time for you to confess to God any sin that God's bringing to mind that you just, God, forgive me. If you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, I encourage you to do that now, to say, God, forgive me of my sin. I'm asking that by what Jesus has done in his life, death, and resurrection, that you would save me and that you'd make me new from the inside out. Whether you prayed that online or whether you prayed it here, your next step is to be baptized. Encourage you. Reach out to him by faith. He's come for you. You're not alone. For those of you who are believers, you can go ahead and take the single-serve communion elements that are on your seat, and you can go ahead and take the bread, remembering that his body was broken for you, for us, for our salvation. Take and eat, all of you, remembering what Christ has done if you're a believer. And those of you who are believers can then take the juice and drink of it, remembering what Christ has done for us. And so, Father, we thank you for your great love for us. Jesus, we thank you for saving us. Spirit, we thank you for staying with us to apply the work of redemption and resurrection in our life until you come again. In Jesus' name, amen.